Understanding the data. Analysis. In this section, we will look into ways to effectively analyse the data collected. A good starting point could be the question, what steps should we take to analyse the data? Looking at data and understanding the meaning can be very simple if you use methods and tricks that facilitate understanding, allow you to quickly highlight the most important meanings and the context in question. For example, sorting data is very useful for better understanding the size of the values being analysed. If your data include a series of values of scale, for example, the number of employed people per region, sorting them from the largest to the smallest, or vice versa, will allow you to quickly understand where employment rates are higher or lower. This is a very simple step. Select the entire column containing the data to be sorted and choose the appropriate option for sorting, usually found in a spreadsheet under Data, Sort. The data can also be filtered. This is very useful if the amount of data you have available is starting to become considerably large. For example, in a data set of 100 rows, it might be difficult to grasp all the main aspects. Ask yourself if you can filter the data by limiting the field to only those of interest and hiding the less relevant data. How do you do this? Simple. Select the entire column containing the data to be filtered, and then the appropriate sorting option, usually found in a spreadsheet under Data, Filter. It's also important to know how to group data. This allows us to make quantitative measurements, at least when the data has homogeneous characteristics. Let's see an example. Take the list of all the projects financed by cohesion policies in your territory. That gives us hundreds, if not thousands, of values. We need to understand how they are distributed by theme, how many refer to environment, transport, culture and tourism, and so on. The objective here is to group by theme to understand how many projects fall under each theme. In this case, the data should be grouped using a pivot table. Select the entire table opened with a spreadsheet and use the relevant option, usually found in Data Pivot Table. Enter theme in the rows area and the count of themes option in the values box. Using one of these methods will not necessarily be sufficient. You may need to use two or three together. For example, having grouped the data as above by theme, it might be useful to sort them from the largest to the smallest. This will help you quickly understand which theme has the largest number of projects. The same could be done to sort projects by economic value. It could also be helpful to filter the data before grouping them, so you can focus only on a subset that interests you. Another important step is correlation of data. Comparing different territories is possible, but you need to consider the differences arising from population or context. Normalizing the data means making our comparison consistent with the context data relating to each territory. We cannot compare, for example, the absolute values of the number of visitors to museums in a small region with those of a large and densely populated region. We have to consider that in these regions, there is a very different number of inhabitants, tourists, and museums. The most commonly used method is to measure data in proportion with the population. For example, the number of bins of differentiated waste in our cities, calculated by number of inhabitants per neighbourhood. This allows us to obtain useful information about waste generation by area. When our data is a subset of a larger group of data relating to the same scope, they can be normalized by creating an indicator. For example, if you are interested in measuring female employment and comparing it, the ideal would be to create an indicator that divides the number of female workers by total employment. As a result, we have the percentage of employed women out of the total number of workers. By not comparing them as a proportion of the entire population, we can thus exclude children and retirees, that is, those who do not work. Thoroughly explore and analyze the data you are collecting for your research and ask yourself, what other information can you cross-check with? Try building new indicators to compare your data with. For example, data of another territory or another subset of data, or even an historical data series related to the chosen topic or type of intervention. Here are five practical tips on the methods illustrated so far. 1. First of all, there is no standard recipe for deciding which method to use. Start from a thorough knowledge of your data. 2. Always keep in mind your objective and ask yourself, why might it be helpful to sort, filter, group, and correlate the data? What will the results tell me? 3. Lighten the data. Remove those that are not helpful for your research and try to focus on smaller data sets. 4. Try multiple times. Explore many paths. Try again and again. And 5. Find the errors, that is, look for the outliers, which are the anomalous values, which can highlight important pieces of information with respect to the overall context. For example, take unemployment rates of 10 regions. The average may vary between 10 and 15%. Then we find one of these regions has an unemployment rate of, let's say, 40%. This would be the outlier, a figure that differs greatly from the normal trend, and therefore may be worth investigating deeper.